Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of The Railway Children by E. Nesbit, narrated by Virginia Leishman.
Chapter 1. The Beginning of Things. They were not railway children to begin with. I don't suppose they had ever thought about railways except as a means of getting to Maskelyne and Cook's, the pantomime, Zoological Gardens, and Madame Tussaud's. They were just ordinary suburban children, and they lived with their father and mother in an ordinary red-brick-fronted villa, with coloured glass in the front door, a tiled passage that was called a hall, a bathroom with hot and cold water, electric bells, French windows, and a good deal of white paint, and every modern convenience, as the house agents say. There were three of them. Roberta was the eldest. Of course, mothers never have favourites, but if their mother had had a favourite, it might have been Roberta. Next came Peter, who wished to be an engineer when he grew up. And the youngest was Phyllis, who meant extremely well. Mother didn't spend all her time in paying dull calls to dull ladies and sitting dully at home waiting for dull ladies to pay calls to her. She was almost always there, ready to play with the children and read to them and help them to do their home lessons. Besides this, she used to write stories for them while they were at school and read them aloud after tea, and she always made up funny pieces of poetry for their birthdays and for other great occasions, such as the christening of the new kittens, or the refurnishing of the doll's house, or the time when they were getting over the mumps. These three lucky children always had everything they needed. Pretty clothes, good fires, a lovely nursery with heaps of toys, and a Mother Goose wallpaper. They had a kind and merry nursemaid, and a dog who was called James, and who was their very own. They also had a father who was just perfect. Never cross, never unjust, and always ready for a game. At least, if at any time he was not ready, he always had an excellent reason for it, and explained the reason to the children so interestingly and funnily that they felt sure he couldn't help himself. You will think that they ought to have been very happy. And so they were. But they did not know how happy, till the pretty life in Edgecombe Villa was over and done with, and they had to live a very different life indeed. The dreadful change came quite suddenly. Peter had a birthday, his 10th. Among his other presents was a model engine more perfect than you could ever have dreamed of. The other presents were full of charm, but the engine was fuller of charm than any of the others were. Its charm lasted in its full perfection for exactly 3 days. Then, owing either to Peter's inexperience or Phyllis's good intentions, which had been rather pressing, or to some other cause, the engine suddenly went off with a bang. James was so frightened that he went out and didn't come back all day. All the Noah's Ark people who were in the tender were broken to bits, but nothing else was hurt except the poor little engine and the feelings of Peter. The others said he cried over it, but of course boys of 10 don't cry, however terrible the tragedies may be which darken their lot. He said that his eyes were red because he had a cold. This turned out to be true, though Peter didn't know it was when he said it. The next day he had to go to bed and stay there. Mother began to be afraid that he might be sickening for measles, when suddenly he sat up in bed and said, "I hate gruel. I hate barley water. I hate bread and milk. I want to get up and have something real to eat." "What would you like?" Mother asked. "A pigeon pie," said Peter eagerly. "A large pigeon pie. A very large one." So Mother asked the cook to make a large pigeon pie. The pie was made. And when the pie was made, it was cooked. And when it was cooked, Peter ate some of it. After that, his cold was better. Mother made a piece of poetry to amuse him while the pie was being made. It began by saying what an unfortunate but worthy boy Peter was, Then it went on. He had an engine that he loved with all his heart and soul, and if he had a wish on earth, it was to keep it whole. One day, my friends, prepare your minds, I'm coming to the worst. Quite suddenly, a screw went mad, and then the boiler burst. With gloomy face, he picked it up and took it to his mother, though even he could not suppose that she could make another. For those who perished on the line, he did not seem to care, his engine being more to him than all the people there. And now you see the reason why our Peter has been ill. He soothes his soul with pigeon pie, his gnawing grief to kill. He wraps himself in blankets warm and sleeps in bed till late, determined thus to overcome his miserable fate. And if his eyes are rather red, his cold must just excuse it. Offer him pie. You may be sure he never will refuse it. Father had been away in the country for 3 or 4 days. All Peter's hopes for the curing of his afflicted engine were now fixed on his father, for father was most wonderfully clever with his fingers. He could mend all sorts of things. He had often acted as veterinary surgeon to the wooden rocking horse. Once he had saved its life when all human aid was despaired of, and the poor creature was given up for lost, and even the carpenter said he didn't see his way to do anything. And it was father who mended the doll's cradle when no one else could, and with a little glue and some bits of wood and a penknife made all the Noah's Ark beasts as strong on their pins as ever they were, if not stronger. Peter, with heroic unselfishness, didn't say anything about his engine till after father had had his dinner and his after-dinner cigar. The unselfishness was mother's idea, but it was Peter who carried it out, and needed a good deal of patience, too. At last, mother said to father, "Now, dear, if you're quite rested and quite comfy, we want to tell you about the great railway accident and ask your advice." "All right," said father, "fire away." So then Peter told the sad tale and fetched what was left of the engine. "Hmm," said father, when he had looked the engine over very carefully. The children held their breaths. "Is there no hope?" said Peter, in a low, unsteady voice.
"Hope? Rather. Tons of it," said father cheerfully. "But it'll want something besides hope. A bit of brazing, say, or some solder, and a new valve. I think we'd better keep it for a rainy day. In other words, I'll give up Saturday afternoon to it, and you shall all help me."
"Can girls help to mend engines?" Peter asked doubtfully.
"Of course they can. Girls are just as clever as boys, and don't you forget it. How would you like to be an engine driver, Phil?"
"My face would be always dirty, wouldn't it?" said Phyllis in unemotional tones. "And I expect I should break something."
"I should just love it," said Roberta. "Do you think I could when I'm grown up, Daddy? Or even a stoker?"
"You mean a fireman," said Daddy, pulling and twisting at the engine. "Well, if you still wish it, when you're grown up, we'll see about making you a firewoman. I remember when I was a boy..."
Just then there was a knock at the front door.
"Who on earth?" said father. "An Englishman's house is his castle, of course, but I do wish they built semi-detached villas with moats and drawbridges."
Ruth, she was the parlour maid and had red hair, came in and said that two gentlemen wanted to see the master.
"I've shown them into the library, sir," said she.
"I expect it's the subscription to the vicar's testimonial," said mother, "or else it's the choir holiday fund. Get rid of them quickly, dear. It does break up an evening so, and it's nearly the children's bedtime."
But father didn't seem to be able to get rid of the gentleman at all quickly.
"I wish we had got a moat and drawbridge," said Roberta. "Then, when we didn't want people, we could just pull up the drawbridge and no one else could get in. I expect father will have forgotten about when he was a boy if they stay much longer."
Mother tried to make the time pass by telling them a new fairy story about a princess with green eyes. But it was difficult because they could hear the voices of father and the gentleman in the library, and Father's voice sounded louder and different from the voice he generally used to people who came about testimonials and holiday funds. Then the library bell rang, and everyone heaved a breath of relief.
"They're going now," said Phyllis. "He's rung to have them shown out."
But instead of showing anybody out, Ruth showed herself in, and she looked queer, the children thought.
"Please, Mum," she said, "the master wants you to just step into the study. He looks like the dead, Mum. I think he's had bad news. You'd best prepare yourself for the worst, Mum. Perhaps it's a death in the family, or a bank busted, or..."
"That'll do, Ruth," said Mother gently. "You can go." Then Mother went into the library. There was more talking. Then the bell rang again, and Ruth fetched a cab. The children heard boots go out and down the steps. The cab drove away, and the front door shut. Then Mother came in. Her dear face was as white as her lace collar, and her eyes looked very big and shining. Her mouth looked just like a line of pale red. Her lips were thin and not their proper shape at all.
"It's bedtime," she said. "Ruth will put you to bed."
"But you promised we should sit up late tonight because Father's come home," said Phyllis.
"Father's been called away, on business," said Mother. "Come, darlings, go at once." They kissed her and went. Roberta lingered to give Mother an extra hug and to whisper,
"It wasn't bad news, Mummy, was it? Is anyone dead, or..."
"Nobody's dead, no," said Mother, and she almost seemed to push Roberta away.
"I can't tell you anything tonight, my pet. Go, dear, go now."
So Roberta went. Ruth brushed the girls' hair and helped them to undress. Mother almost always did this herself. When she had turned down the gas and left them, she found Peter, still dressed, waiting on the stairs.
"I say, Ruth, what's up?" he asked.
"Don't ask me no questions, and I won't tell you no lies," the red-headed Ruth replied. "You'll know soon enough."
Late that night, Mother came up and kissed all three children as they lay asleep. But Roberta was the only one whom the kiss woke, and she lay mousy still and said nothing.
"If Mother doesn't want us to know she's been crying," she said to herself, as she heard through the dark the catching of her mother's breath, "we won't know it, that's all."
When they came down to breakfast the next morning, Mother had already gone out.
"To London," Ruth said, and left them to their breakfast.
"There's something awful the matter," said Peter, breaking his egg. "Ruth told me last night we should know soon enough."
"Did you ask her?"
said Roberta with scorn.
"Yes, I did," said Peter angrily. "If you could go to bed without caring whether Mother was worried or not, I couldn't, so there."
"I don't think we ought to ask the servants things Mother doesn't tell us," said Roberta.
"That's right, Miss Goody-Goody," said Peter. "Preach away."
"I'm not goody," said Phyllis, "but I think Bobby's right this time."
"Of course, she always is, in her own opinion," said Peter.
"Oh, don't," cried Roberta, putting down her egg spoon. "Don't let's be horrid to each other. I'm sure some dire calamity is happening. Don't let's make it worse."
"Who began, I should like to know," said Peter.
Roberta made an effort and answered,
"I did, I suppose, but..."
"Well, then," said Peter triumphantly.
But before he went to school, he thumped his sister between the shoulders and told her to cheer up. The children came home to 1 o'clock dinner, but Mother wasn't there. And she wasn't there at tea time. It was nearly 7 before she came in, looking so ill and tired that the children felt they couldn't ask her any questions. She sank into an armchair. Phyllis took the long pins out of her hat, while Roberta took off her gloves, and Peter unfastened her walking shoes and fetched her soft velvety slippers for her. When she'd had a cup of tea, and Roberta had put eau de cologne on her poor head that ached, Mother said,
"Now, my darlings,
I want to tell you something. Those men last night did bring very bad news, and Father will be away for some time. I am very worried about it, and I want you all to help me and not to make things harder for me.
As if we would,
said Roberta, holding Mother's hand against her face. You can help me very much, said Mother, by being good and happy and not quarrelling when I'm away. Roberta and Peter exchanged guilty glances, for I shall have to be away a good deal.
We won't quarrel, indeed we won't,
said everybody, and meant it too. Then, Mother went on, I want you not to ask me any questions about this trouble, and not to ask anybody else any questions. Peter cringed and shuffled his boots on the carpet. You'll promise this too, won't you? Said Mother.
I did ask Ruth, said Peter suddenly. I'm very sorry, but I did.
And what did she say?
She said I should know soon enough.
It isn't necessary for you to know anything about it, said Mother. It's about business, and you never do understand business, do you?
No, said Roberta. Is it something to do with government?
For Father was in a government office.
Yes, said Mother. Now it's bedtime, my darlings, and don't you worry. It'll all come right in the end. Then don't you worry either, Mother, said Phyllis, and we'll all be as good as gold.
Mother sighed and kissed them.
We'll begin being good the first thing tomorrow morning, said Peter as they went upstairs.
Why not now? Said Roberta.
"'Tis nothing to be good about now, silly, said Peter. We might begin to try to feel good, said Phyllis, and not call names. Who's calling names? Said Peter. Bobby knows right enough that when I say silly, it's just the same as if I said Bobby.
Well, said Roberta.
No, I don't mean what you mean. I mean it's just a... What is it Father calls it? A germ of endearment. Good night.
The girls folded up their clothes with more than usual neatness, which was the only way of being good that they could think of.
I say, said Phyllis, smoothing out her pinafore, you used to say it was so dull, nothing happening like in books. Now something has happened.
I never wanted things to happen to make Mother unhappy, said Roberta. Everything's perfectly horrid. Everything continued to be perfectly horrid for some weeks. Mother was nearly always out. Meals were dull and dirty. The between maid was sent away, and Aunt Emma came on a visit. Aunt Emma was much older than Mother. She was going abroad to be a governess. She was very busy getting her clothes ready, and they were very ugly, dingy clothes, and she had them always littering about, and the sewing machine seemed to whirl on and on all day and most of the night. Aunt Emma believed in keeping children in their proper places, and they more than returned the compliment. Their idea of Aunt Emma's proper place was anywhere where they were not, so they saw very little of her. They preferred the company of the servants, who were more amusing. Cook, if in a good temper, could sing comic songs, and the housemaid, if she happened not to be offended with you, could imitate a hen that has laid an egg, a bottle of champagne being opened, and could mew like two cats fighting. The servants never told the children what the bad news was that the gentleman had brought to Father, but they kept hinting that they could tell a great deal if they chose, and this was not comfortable. One day, when Peter had made a booby trap over the bathroom door, and it had acted beautifully as Ruth passed through, that red-haired parlour-maid caught him and boxed his ears.
"You'll come to a bad end," she said furiously. "You nasty little limb, you! If you don't mend your ways, you'll go straight where your precious father's gone, so I tell you straight."
Roberta repeated this to her mother, and next day Ruth was sent away. Then came the time when Mother came home and went to bed and stayed there 2 days, and the doctor came, and the children crept wretchedly about the house and wondered if the world was coming to an end. Mother came down one morning to breakfast, very pale and with lines on her face that used not to be there. And she smiled, as well as she could, and said, "Now, my pets, everything is settled. We're going to leave this house and go and live in the country. Such a ducky, dear little white house. I know you'll love it." A whirling week of packing followed. Not just packing clothes, like when you go to the seaside, but packing chairs and tables, covering their tops with sacking and their legs with straw. All sorts of things were packed that you don't pack when you go to the seaside. Crockery, blankets, candlesticks, carpets, bedsteads, saucepans, and even fenders and fire irons. The house was like a furniture warehouse. I think the children enjoyed it very much. Mother was very busy, but not too busy now to talk to them and read to them, and even to make a bit of poetry for Phyllis to cheer her up when she fell down with a screwdriver and ran it into her hand. "Aren't you going to pack this, Mother?" Roberta asked, pointing to the beautiful cabinet inlaid with red turtle shell and brass. "We can't take everything," said Mother. "But we seem to be taking all the ugly things," said Roberta. "We're taking the useful ones," said Mother. "We've got to play at being poor for a bit, my chickabiddy." When all the ugly, useful things had been packed up and taken away in a van by men in green baize aprons, the two girls and Mother and Aunt Emma slept in the two spare rooms, where the furniture was all pretty. All their beds had gone. A bed was made up for Peter on the drawing-room sofa. "I say, this is larks," he said, wriggling joyously as Mother tucked him up. "I do like moving. I wish we moved once a month." Mother laughed. "I don't," she said. "Good night, Peterkin." As she turned away, Roberta saw her face. She never forgot it. "Oh, Mother," she whispered all to herself as she got into bed, "how brave you are. How I love you. Fancy being brave enough to laugh when you're feeling like that." Next day, boxes were filled, and boxes and more boxes. And then, late in the afternoon, a cab came to take them to the station. Aunt Emma saw them off. They felt that they were seeing her off, and they were glad of it. "But, oh, those poor little foreign children that she's going to govern us," whispered Phyllis. "I wouldn't be them for anything." At first they enjoyed looking out of the window, but when it grew dusk, they grew sleepier and sleepier. And no one knew how long they'd been in the train when they were roused by Mother's shaking them gently and saying, "Wake up, dears. We're there." They woke up cold and melancholy and stood shivering on the draughty platform while the baggage was taken out of the train. Then the engine, puffing and blowing, set to work again and dragged the train away. The children watched the tail lights of the guard's van disappear into the darkness. This was the first train the children saw on that railway which was in time to become so very dear to them. They didn't guess then how they would grow to love the railway, and how soon it would become the centre of their new life, nor what wonders and changes it would bring to them. They only shivered and sneezed and hoped the walk to the new house would not be long. Peter's nose was colder than he ever remembered it to have been before. Roberta's hat was crooked, and the elastic seemed tighter than usual. Phyllis's shoelaces had come undone. "Come," said Mother, "we've got to walk. There aren't any cabs here." The walk was dark and muddy. The children stumbled a little on the rough road, and once Phyllis absently fell into a puddle and was picked up damp and unhappy. There were no gas lamps on the road, and the road was uphill. The cart went at a slow pace, and they followed the gritty crunch of its wheels. As their eyes got used to the darkness, they could see the mound of boxes swaying dimly in front of them. A long gate had to be opened for the cart to pass through, and after that the road seemed to go across fields. And now it went downhill. Presently, a great dark, lumpish thing showed over to the right. "There's the house," said Mother. "I wonder why she's shut the shutters."
"Who's she?"
asked Roberta. "The woman I engaged to clean the place and put the furniture straight and get supper." There was a low wall and trees inside.
"That's the garden," said Mother.
"It looks more like a dripping pan full of black cabbages," said Peter.
The cart went on along by the garden wall and round to the back of the house, and here it clattered into a cobblestone yard and stopped at the back door. There was no light in any of the windows. Everyone hammered at the door, but no one came. The man who drove the cart said he expected Mrs. Viney had gone home.
"You see, your train was that late," said he.
"But she's got the key," said Mother. "What are we to do?"
"Oh, she'll have left that under the doorstep," said the cartman. "Folks do hereabouts."
He took the lantern off his cart and stooped.
"Aye, here it is, right enough," he said.
He unlocked the door and went in and set his lantern on the table.
"Got her a candle?" said he.
"I don't know where anything is."
Mother spoke rather less cheerfully than usual. He struck a match. There was a candle on the table, and he lighted it. By its thin little glimmer, the children saw a large, bare kitchen with a stone floor. There were no curtains, no hearth rug. The kitchen table from home stood in the middle of the room. The chairs were in one corner, and the pots, pans, brooms, and crockery in another. There was no fire, and the black grate showed cold, dead ashes. As the cartman turned to go out after he had brought in the boxes, there was a rustling, scampering sound that seemed to come from inside the walls of the house.
"Oh, what's that?" cried the girls.
"It's only the rats," said the cartman,
and he went away and shut the door, and the sudden draught of it blew out the candle.
"Oh, dear," said Phyllis. "I wish we hadn't come,"
and she knocked a chair over.
"Only the rats,"
said Peter, in the dark. Chapter 2. Peter's Coal Mine. "What fun," said Mother, in the dark, feeling for the matches on the table. "How frightened the poor mice were. I don't believe they were rats at all." She struck a match and relighted the candle, and everyone looked at each other by its winky-blinky light. "Well," she said, "you've often wanted something to happen, and now it has. This is quite an adventure, isn't it? I told Mrs. Viney to get us some bread and butter and meat and things, and to have supper ready. I suppose she has laid it in the dining room, so let's go and see." The dining room opened out of the kitchen. It looked much darker than the kitchen when they went in with the one candle, because the kitchen was whitewashed, but the dining room was dark wood from floor to ceiling, and across the ceiling there were heavy black beams. There was a muddle maze of dusty furniture, the breakfast room furniture from the old home where they had lived all their lives. It seemed a very long time ago, and a very long way off. There was a table, certainly, and there were chairs, but there was no supper. "Let's look in the other rooms," said Mother, and they looked. And in each room was the same kind of blundering half-arrangement of furniture and fire-irons and crockery and all sorts of odd things on the floor, but there was nothing to eat. Even in the pantry there were only a rusty cake tin and a broken plate with whitening mixed in it. "What a horrid old woman," said Mother. "She's just walked off with the money and not got us anything to eat at all."
"Then shan't we have any supper at all?"
asked Phyllis, dismayed, stepping back onto a soap dish that cracked responsively.
"Oh, yes," said Mother. "Only it'll mean unpacking one of those big cases that we put in the cellar. Phil, do mind where you're walking to, there's a dear.
Peter, hold the light. The cellar door opened out of the kitchen. There were 5 wooden steps leading down. It wasn't a proper cellar at all, the children thought, because its ceiling went up as high as the kitchen's. A bacon rack hung under its ceiling. There was wood in it and coal. Also the big cases. Peter held the candle, all on one side, while Mother tried to open the great packing case. It was very securely nailed down.
"Where's the hammer?" asked Peter. "That's just it," said Mother. "I'm afraid it's inside the box. But there's a coal shovel, and there's the kitchen poker."
And with these she tried to get the case open.
"Let me do it," said Peter, thinking he could do it better himself. Everyone thinks this when he sees another person stirring a fire or opening a box or untying a knot in a bit of string.
"You'll hurt your hands, Mummy," said Roberta. "Let me."
"I wish Father was here," said Phyllis. "He'd get it open in 2 shakes. What are you kicking me for, Bobby?"
"I wasn't," said Roberta.
Just then the first of the long nails in the packing case began to come out with a scrunch. Then a lath was raised, and then another, till all 4 stood up with long nails in them shining fiercely like iron teeth in the candlelight.
"Hooray!" said Mother. "Here are some candles, the very first thing. You girls go and light them. You'll find some saucers and things. Just drop a little candle grease in the saucer and stick the candle upright in it.
How many shall we light?"
"As many as ever you like," said Mother gaily. "The great thing is to be cheerful. Nobody can be cheerful in the dark, except owls and dormice."
So the girls lighted candles. The head of the first match flew off and stuck to Phyllis's finger. But, as Roberta said, it was only a little burn, and she might have had to be a Roman martyr and be burned whole if she had happened to live in the days when those things were fashionable. Then, when the dining room was lighted by 14 candles, Roberta fetched coal and wood and lighted a fire.
"It's very cold for me," she said, feeling what a grown-up thing it was to say.
The firelight and the candlelight made the dining room look very different, for now you could see that the dark walls were of wood, carved here and there into little wreaths and loops. The girls hastily tidied the room, which meant putting the chairs against the wall and piling all the odds and ends into a corner and partly hiding them with the big leather armchair that Father used to sit in after dinner.
"Bravo!" cried Mother, coming in with a tray full of things. "This is something like. I'll just get a tablecloth, and then..."
The tablecloth was in a box with a proper lock that was opened with a key and not with a shovel. And when the cloth was spread on the table, a real feast was laid out on it. Everyone was very, very tired, but everyone cheered up at the sight of the funny and delightful supper. There were biscuits, the Marie and the plain kind, sardines, preserved ginger, cooking raisins, and candied peel and marmalade.
"What a good thing Aunt Emma packed up all the odds and ends out of the store cupboard," said Mother. "Now, Phil, don't put the marmalade spoon in among the sardines."
"No, I won't, Mother," said Phyllis,
and put it down among the Marie biscuits.
"Let's drink Aunt Emma's health," said Roberta suddenly. "What would we have done if she hadn't packed up these things? Here's to Aunt Emma."
And the toast was drunk in ginger wine and water, out of willow-pattern teacups, because the glasses couldn't be found. They all felt that they'd been a little hard on Aunt Emma. She wasn't a nice, cuddly person like Mother, but after all, it was she who had thought of packing up the odds and ends of things to eat. It was Aunt Emma, too, who had aired all the sheets ready, and the men who had moved the furniture had put the bedsteads together, so the beds were soon made. "Good night, chickies," said Mother. "I'm sure there aren't any rats, but I'll leave my door open, and then if a mouse comes, you need only scream, and I'll come and tell it exactly what I think of it." Then she went to her own room. Roberta woke to hear the little travelling clock chime 2. It sounded like a church clock ever so far away, she always thought. And she heard, too, Mother still moving about in her room. Next morning, Roberta woke Phyllis by pulling her hair gently, but quite enough for her purpose.
"What's the matter?"
asked Phyllis, still almost wholly asleep.
Wake up," said Roberta. "We're in the new house, don't you remember? No servants or anything. Let's get up and begin to be useful. We'll just creep down mouse quietly and have everything beautiful before Mother gets up. I've woken Peter. He'll be dressed as soon as we are."
So they dressed quietly and quickly. Of course, there was no water in their room, so when they got down, they washed as much as they thought was necessary under the spout of the pump in the yard. One pumped and the other washed. It was splashy, but interesting.
"It's much more fun than basin washing," said Roberta. "How sparkly the weeds are between the stones, and the moss on the roof. Oh, and the flowers!"
The roof of the back kitchen sloped down quite low. It was made of thatch, and it had moss on it, and house leeks, and stonecrop, and wallflowers, and even a clump of purple flag flowers at the far corner.
"This is far, far and away prettier than Edgecombe Villa," said Phyllis. "I wonder what the garden's like."
"We mustn't think of the garden yet," said Roberta, with earnest energy. "Let's go in and begin to work."
They lighted the fire and put the kettle on, and they arranged the crockery for breakfast. They couldn't find all the right things, but a glass ashtray made an excellent salt cellar, and a newish baking tin seemed as if it would do to put bread on, if they had any. When there seemed to be nothing more that they could do, they went out again into the fresh, bright morning.
"We'll go into the garden now," said Peter.
But somehow they couldn't find the garden. They went round the house and round the house. The yard occupied the back, and across it were stables and outbuildings. On the other three sides, the house stood simply in a field, without a yard of garden to divide it from the short, smooth turf. And yet they had certainly seen the garden wall the night before. It was a hilly country. Down below, they could see the line of the railway and the black, yawning mouth of a tunnel. The station was out of sight. There was a great bridge with tall arches running across one end of the valley.
"Never mind the garden," said Peter. "Let's go down and look at the railway. There might be trains passing."
"We can see them from here," said Roberta slowly. "Let's sit down a bit." So they all sat down on a great flat grey stone that had pushed itself up out of the grass. It was one of many that lay about on the hillside. And when Mother came out to look for them at 8 o'clock, she found them deeply asleep in a contented, sun-warmed bunch. They had made an excellent fire and had set the kettle on it at about 5:30, so that by 8 the fire had been out for some time, the water had all boiled away, and the bottom was burned out of the kettle. Also, they had not thought of washing the crockery before they set the table.
"But it doesn't matter, the cups and saucers, I mean," said Mother, "because I've found another room. I'd quite forgotten there was one. And it's magic. And I've boiled the water for tea in a saucepan."
The forgotten room opened out of the kitchen. In the agitation and half-darkness the night before, its door had been mistaken for a cupboard's. It was a little square room, and on its table, all nicely set out, was a joint of cold roast beef, with bread and butter, cheese, and a pie.
"Pie for breakfast!" cried Peter. "How perfectly ripping!"
"It isn't pigeon pie," said Mother. "It's only apple." "Well, this is the supper we ought to have had last night." And there was a note from Mrs. Viney, Her son-in-law has broken his arm and she had to get home early. She's coming this morning at 10. That was a wonderful breakfast. It is unusual to begin the day with cold apple pie, but the children all said they would rather have it than meat.
You see, it's more like dinner than breakfast to us, said Peter, passing his plate for more, because we were up so early.
The day passed in helping Mother to unpack and arrange things. Six small legs quite ached with running about while their owners carried clothes and crockery and all sorts of things to their proper places.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.